Excel podcast is sponsored by Easy Excel. Learn Excel from Mr. Excel podcast episode 1746. Extract records with a formula. Hey, welcome back to the Mr. Excel netcast. I'm Bill Jell, and today's question is sent in by Nermal. Nermal has a large data set. He has several criteria fields. He had three, I have four, and wanted to have a formula so when the customer changed, the formula would automatically extract the matching records. All right, so let's just try this here. We're going to change from General Motors to Exxon. Okay, well, now this is not a formula. This is an advanced filter. And unfortunately, I said, well, hey, this is going to be easy. Just come back here to data, filter, and reapply. Oh, but you can't reapply an advanced filter. You have to go through all the steps again. Filter, advanced, copy to another location, click OK, and then you get the new records. And, you know, you can't expect the person using your spreadsheet to go through all of those steps each time. So we need a formula. And I'm going to plug Mike's book here. Starting today at MrExcel.com, go to eBooks, the Ctrl+Shift+Enter ePub, which is either PDF for your computer, ePub for your iPad, or Mobi for your Kindle, is out. So I bought this book, and I read through the book, and there's a chapter there on extracting records. And if you watch the Dueling podcast, you know that Mike is really good at these array formulas, and I'm really bad at them, but I want to show you what I've learned by reading Mike's book. So we're going to go here to a formula that I built based on Mike's book. And the big thing is we have our input cells, right? So we have some criteria, and the brunt of the formulas down here are going to be index. We're going to go back to the original data set, use the index function to pull out a specific record number. So here we're pulling out record number 16, which is down in row 17, and I'm getting the date, the invoice number, the revenue, and the open balance to be pulled over here using index functions, all right? So the index function is not what we're going to talk about today. What we're really going to talk about today is how to get the record numbers. That's the magic. That's the array formula that is all the magic. And you'll see the formula up here, and we'll come back to this formula, but I want to explain it in a simpler instance. And then in this instance, we just have one criteria. We have a small data set here with 10 rows. I choose a customer here, and I want to extract the records for that customer. And I'll show you that it's working. If I would type in Ford, all of this information changes to give me the Ford records. Okay, so we'll go back to Exxon, and we'll talk about how this formula is working. All right, what we start with inside, deep inside the array formula, is an if function. All right, and think about an if function. It says, you know, if logical test is true. So we're checking all of the customers from C2 to C11 to see if they're equal to Exxon, which is stored in H2, and I have dollar signs there. Okay, so we're checking to see if each of those are true. And as you can imagine, we're gonna get a series of falses and trues. If it's Exxon, it's false, 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 true, false, false, true, false, false, true, false. All right, that's gonna be the results of the if function. And then what do we do if it's true? If it's true, I want the row number of that record minus the row number of the headers. The headers are in row one. So we take the row of each record minus one. And if you look down here, what happens is because we've specified what to do if it's true, but we haven't specified what to do if it's false, the if function is giving us a bunch of falses. So we're getting false, false, and then a record number. False, false, and then a record number. False, false, and then a record number. And actually, that text right there is wrong. There should be one more false going in there. All right, so here, let me edit that just so we are correct. All right. Now, so that piece of the array function, the if and the row minus one, is returning a lot of falses when the record doesn't match, and it's returning the row number when the record does match. Now the trick to this is to pass that array of falses and numbers to the small function. What is the small function? I'm sure you've used min and max. Min and max get us the smallest value and the largest value, but small lets us specify a range, and comma one to get the smallest value, comma two to get the second smallest value, comma three to get the third smallest value, and so on. And so by passing that array to the small and asking for the first smallest item, it's going to give us the three. And sure enough, right there, we get a three. That's the first one that matches. Let's change this to Ford. And while my text down here won't change, we're going to get false, 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 4, 5, false, 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 10. So the smallest from that array of values I just said is going to be the number 4. And then by using row of A1 here, that's the world's geekiest way of writing the number 1, so equal row of A1. When we copy that down, it automatically row of A1 changes to A2, A3, A4, A5, which gives us a series of numbers. So in F8, it's the same set of small n numbers, but we're asking for the row of B1, which is the second value, which gets us the second value there. All right, so when you kind of break it down, that was an intimidating formula, but you can see how the guts in here, the if function, is really kind of common, right? We're checking each of the customers to see if it's equal to Ford or to Exxon, and if it is, give us the row number that appears. But then, to me, the really clever part is using small, knowing that small is going to ignore the falses, and just give us the numeric values. All right, now, in real life, you would have to extend this formula down so that way it was far enough to include the largest possible value. And so in my formula back here, that's why I wrapped it in the if error to give me quote, quote, if in fact there was nothing there. So I copied my formula down more rows than I thought I would need, and I'm just going to get some blanks here. I also used if error around the index to make sure that I get quote, quote on the inside. Now, in this case, so in the simple case, we had just one criteria. Is it the customer? With three criteria or four criteria, you would think that you would go out and use an and function, right? Like this. But the and function doesn't work with array formulas. And that's not really documented anywhere, but it is documented in Mike's book. And I appreciate that. Mike's book goes through and talks about, out of the 468 functions, which ones will work with array formulas and which ones won't. That's a great thing. So when we come back here, instead of using the and function like you would think you would want to use, we have to nest if statements. Do the first test, and then another if statement with the second test, and then another if statement with the third test, and then, in my case, another if statement with the fourth test. If all of that is true, then give me the row, and I don't bother to put what to do if it's false. That way, the if function gives me false. I just close 1, 2, 3, 4 if statements right there, and we get our answer. So let's try it here. We'll put in Ford, and all of the data down there changes to reflect the new information. Let's try a smaller one. I think Citigroup only has a few records. I don't know, it has a lot. Who's small? Verizon. There you go. So you get fewer records. The beautiful thing about this, well, these formulas are expensive and cost a lot of calculation time because they're doing, you know, in this case, I think 563 tests for every single row here. It is cool that you don't have to run the advanced filter again. So there's times, especially in Nermal's case, remember Nermal asked the question today, where this will solve the problem. All right, so again, check out Mike Girvin's book. It's at the printers right now, but the ebook is out. If you want to read it on your screen, the PDF or the ePub or the Kindle edition is available now at MrExcel.com. Probably in a couple of weeks, the print edition will be making its way out. A great resource on array formulas. They're just poorly documented elsewhere, and this, for the first time in one place, puts all kinds of great information about array formulas. So check out that book from Mike Girvin. I want to thank Nermal for sending that question in. I want to thank you for stopping by. I want to thank Mike for teaching about array formulas. We'll see you next time for another netcast from Mr. Excel.